Welcome back once again. Congestion. What is congestion? If too many packets are present in a network, it will affect the speed or the efficiency of a network. And this situation is actually known as congestion. So we can define it as congestion in a network may occur if the load on the network, that is the number of packets sent to the network, is greater than the capacity of the network. So if the network is not able to handle its load, it will affect the speed or the efficiency of the network. And which is very important, the speed is very important in the case of a network. So, for a network to function properly, there must be some mechanisms to control or to prevent or to remove congestion. So in this session I am going to deal with congestion control. Congestion control techniques and mechanisms can either prevent congestion before it happens or remove congestion after it has happened. That means we have congestion prevention and also congestion removal. In general, we can divide congestion control mechanisms into two categories, that is open loop congestion control and closed loop congestion control. Open loop congestion control is actually congestion prevention mechanism, and closed loop congestion control is that of removal, congestion removal. So we are going to discuss about this open loop congestion control and closed loop congestion control. So the figure shows the congestion control categories. Here the open loop and here the closed loop, two categories. And in open loop, the important mechanisms are retransmission policy, window policy, acknowledgement policy, discard pin policy, and admission policy. And in closed loop, that is removal, the techniques used are back pressure, choke packet, implicit signaling, explicit signaling. We can learn one by one. Open loop congestion control. So, as I told earlier, open loop congestion control is applied to prevent congestion before it happens. And this type of congestion control is handled either by the source or the destination. So first one is retransmission policy. As you know, retransmission is sometimes unavoidable. In many situations, the source need to retransmit the packets. Some of the situations are, if the sent packet is lost or corrupted, then the source has to, or the sender has to, retransmit it. Or sometimes the packet may be delivered properly, but due to some reasons it gets time out. In such a situation also retransmission take place. So whatever it is, retransmission in general will increase congestion in the network, because the number of packets or load on the network is increasing. So in a network there must be a good retransmission policy by which we can prevent congestion. So we know there are timers, so retransmission policy as well as retransmission timers must be designed in such a way that it should optimize the efficiency, at the same time prevent congestion. Second one is window policy. The type of window at the sender may affect congestion. And in the case of window, we have already dealt with selective repeat window and go back N window. In selective repeat window, we are repeating or retransmitting only selected, or in other words only the lost or corrupted packets. For example, suppose the window size is 7 and the second package is lost. So in a selective repeat window, only that second packet will be retransmitted. But in the case of go back N window, if the second packet is lost, then all the packets from 2nd to 7th will be retransmitted. So it is clear that go back N will cause too many packets in the network. So as far as congestion control is considered, selective repeat window is better than go back N. Third one is acknowledgement policy. When a packet is sent from the source to destination, networks keeps the idea of acknowledgement. If the receiver keeps on sending acknowledgements for each and every packet received, this may increase the load of the network, because acknowledgements are also a part of load. That means both data packets as well as acknowledgement packets cause the load in a network. So by using a proper acknowledgement policy, we can control congestion, or we can prevent congestion. The idea is, if the receiver does not acknowledge every packet it receives, it may slow down the sender and help in prevent congestion. Several approaches are there. First one, a receiver may send an acknowledgement only if it has a packet to send. That is, it is using piggybacking. So piggybacking is a policy, is a good acknowledgement policy in connection with congestion prevention. And even a receiver may wait until a special timer expires. Then another idea is, a receiver may decide to acknowledge only N packets at a time. Means instead of acknowledging each and every packet one by one, N packets are acknowledged. This situation we have seen with TCP. There the acknowledgement number is, for example, if the acknowledgement number is 105, it means all the packets or all the segments up to 104 are received safely, and it is expecting the packet with the sequence number 105. So instead of sending acknowledgement for packets from 100, 101 to 105, it is sending only a single acknowledgement, and this is a part of good acknowledgement policy in connection with congestion control. 4. Discarding policy. Routers may discard packets due to many reasons. So, a good discarding policy by the routers may prevent congestion. For example, take the case of audio transmission. And suppose we are using the policy to discard less sensitive packets when congestion is likely to happen. That is, if we are expecting, or if the system is expecting congestion, less sensitive packets are discarded by the router. By discarding such less sensitive packet, it will not affect the quality of sound. So, by doing this, congestion is prevented or congestion is controlled. 5. Admission policy. This is the idea of deciding whether to admit a packet into the network or not. This is because if there is a possibility of congestion in the network, it is better not to push or not to send more packets into the network. If you are doing so, it will cause congestion or it will increase congestion level. So this admission policy is actually implemented in virtual circuit networks. In this, switches in a flow first check the resource requirement of a flow before admitting it to the network. A router can delay establishing a virtual circuit connection if there is congestion in the network or if there is a possibility of future congestion. If there is no such risk of congestion, then only the router allows establishment of the virtual circuit. 6. Closed loop congestion control. Closed loop congestion control mechanisms try to reduce or resolve congestion once it has happened. The different methods used are, first one, back pressure. It refers to a congestion control mechanism in which a congested node or nodes stops receiving data from the immediate upstream node or nodes. This may cause the upstream node or nodes to become congested. So, in turn, it will reject data from its upstream node or nodes, and so on. So, back pressure is considered to be a node-to-node congestion control. And it starts with a node, and it propagates back, or back in the sense in the opposite direction of data flow, and finally it reaches the source. So once this back pressure reaches the source, source will understand that congestion has occurred. So based on that, source can take some action. It can slow down or stop sending like that. And this idea is used in virtual circuit network, in which each node knows the upstream node from which the flow of data is coming. This can be explained with the help of an example, help of the figure as follows. So here is the source and here is the destination, and from source to destination, this is the data flow direction. And here are nodes numbered as 1, 2, 3 and 4. And suppose congestion has happened in node 3. So when it identifies congestion, it will reject the packets from node 2. That is, data is coming from source to node 1, then to node 2 and then to node 3. So for node 3, data is coming from node 2. So when node 3 gets congested, it will discard or rejects the packets from, rejects the data from node 2 and inform node 2 that it is not able to process it and congestion has occurred. Now what happens is, node 2 gets congested as it cannot forward the packets received to node 3. So node 2 starts rejecting packets from node 1 and it informs, in other words, it informs node 1 about the congestion. Similarly, node 1 also informs the source. And once this information reaches the source, source will take remedial action. Thus, the pressure on node 3, the pressure in the sense, the problem of congestion, the pressure on node 3 is moved backward to the source to remove congestion, and that is the name back pressure. And the important thing to note is that it cannot be implemented in a datagram network. This is because in datagram networks, a node or router does not have any knowledge about the upstream router, or in other words, the node does not know from where its data is coming. So we can apply it to virtual circuit only. Second method is choke packet. This is a special packet, we can say like that. This is a packet sent by a node to the source to inform the source about the congestion. So here also the information is passed to source. In the choke packet method, the warning is from the router which has encountered the congestion to the source directly. We can compare the idea of choke packet and back pressure. In back pressure also, the back pressure or the information regarding congestion is started from the node where congestion has identified. In the case of choke packet also, it is the same case. But the difference is that in back pressure, the warning about congestion is transfer from the congested node to its previous one, and from there to its previous one, and finally reaches the source. Whereas in the case of choke packet method, this warning or information regarding congestion is sent from the congested router to the source directly. In other words, the intermediate nodes through which the packet has traveled are not warned, or they are not aware of this situation. This can be represented as follows. The same figure I am using, from the source to destination, letter flow direction is shown, and here the node 3, as in the same case of back pressure, node 3 is congested. But here the choke packet is sent, this is a special packet itself, it is sent from the congested node to the source, or the source is informed directly. That is the case of choke packet. But in the case of back pressure method, there is no such special packet. Actually, what happens is the congested node stops receiving packets from the previous node. Implicit signaling. In this, there is no communication between the congested node or nodes and the source. So in the case of back pressure and choke packet, the source is informed about congestion. But in the case of implicit signaling, there is no such communication between the congested node and the source. Then how it happens, or how it is implemented? Here the source guesses that there is congestion. The source is making a guess that there is a congestion somewhere in the network from some symptoms. For example, when the source sends several packets and there is no acknowledgement for a while, that the source is waiting for the acknowledgement for a long time. This delay in receiving an acknowledgement is interpreted as congestion in the network. So, as the acknowledgements are not received, the source will slow down, or source will stop sending more packets, which will help in resolving congestion. Explicit signaling. In this, a node that experiences congestion can explicitly send a signal to source or destination. So we can compare with the previous methods. In the case of back pressure and choke packet, the source is informed. In the case of implicit signaling, there is no such signal or no such information is passed to source or destination. It is just a guess. But in the case of explicit signaling, the information about congestion is explicitly sent to source or destination. Here, this signal about the congestion is actually included in the packets that carry data. That is, we are superimposing this congestion signal along with a data signal or a data packet. Whereas in choke packet method, a separate packet is used for this purpose. And explicit signaling can occur in either forward direction or backward direction. Forward direction, if it is in forward direction, it is known as forward signaling. If it is in backward direction, it is known as backward signaling. So we can see both the backward signal. Here a bit can be sent in a packet moving in the direction opposite to congestion. That is, from source to destination data is flowing, and here a bit is sent along with the packet in a direction opposite to congestion, and this bit warns the source that there is a congestion. That is, this bit travels in the direction opposite to direction of data flow. And now what happens is the source will slow down to avoid discarding of packets. Next is forward signaling. Here the difference is a bit can be set in a packet moving in the direction of congestion. So here the information or the warning is received by the destination. So it is up to the receiver to solve congestion. So now the receiver will use policies such as slowing down acknowledgement to reduce congestion. That's all about congestion control. Thank you.